Good morning, all. Today, as Anne discussed, as introduced me, I'm Sujit Babu, working as Assistant Professor, Department of Psychology, University of Kerala. Today, we select topic is dialectical behavior therapy. We know that it's a well-known psychotherapy for dealing personality disorders, especially borderline personality disorder. This is considered as a third wave cognitive behavior therapy approach, dialectical behavior therapy, mindfulness-based other therapies like mindfulness-based stress reduction, acceptance and commitment therapy. These are all considered as third wave cognitive behavior therapy. This particular approach or the particular therapy developed by Marsha Linehan, she is an American psychologist. She has completed her education in Washington University, and she is currently working as an adjunct faculty in Washington University. She was suffering with schizophrenia. That was the diagnosis given by the treatment team when she was in adolescent period of time. She was treated with electroconvulsive therapy and other pharmacotherapies. And after when she got discharged at the age of 18 and later, she herself identified that she has a kind of personality disorder kind of symptoms, basically borderline personality symptoms. Through that, actually, she developed from her own experiences, she developed this particular approach, dialectical behavior therapy. Beginning, she tried to apply cognitive behavior therapy for managing her issues. Later, she added certain component to it, that is mindfulness kind of components. സോ അങ്ങനെ അതിലൂടെയാണ് ഡയലക്ടിക്കൽ ബിഹേവിയർ തെറപ്പി എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞൊരു അപ്രോച്ച് വരുന്നത്. സോ എംപിരിക്കലി ദിസ് ഈസ് കൺസിഡേർഡ് ഡയലക്ടിക് ബിഹേവിയർ തെറപ്പി ദർ ആർ ലോട്ട്സ് ഓഫ് റിസർച്ചസ് കണ്ടക്റ്റഡ് ആൻഡ് ദിസ് ഈസ് കൺസിഡേർഡ് ആസ് ദ മോസ്റ്റ് എംപിരിക്കലി സപ്പോർട്ടഡ് ട്രീറ്റ്മെൻറ്റ് പ്രൊസീജിയർ ഫോർ ബോർഡർ ലൈൻ പേഴ്സണാലിറ്റി ഡിസോർഡർ. ദ എഫിക്കസി ഓഫ് ദ തെറപ്പി ഈസ് വെൽ എസ്റ്റാബ്ലിഷ്ഡ് ആൻഡ് ഇറ്റ്സ് വെരി മച്ച് ഹെൽപ്പിംഗ് ഫോർ suicidal and self-harm behavior symptoms in personality disorders. It's not only for borderline personality or emotionally unstable personality disorder. Even with other cluster B and personality disorder with suicidal tendency and self-harm behaviors, this therapy has great efficacy. Before going into the detail of the dialectical behavior therapy, we need to understand what is dialectical mean. What is dialectical? So simply we can say that in dialectical means the two ideas can both be true at the same time. See, simply we can say that there is nothing good or bad. So it is always a mixture of. So when we are interacting with a person or something, so we don't need to think only the negative side or the positive side. We are mixed of that. That is a kind of perspective actually. So when we are interacting with a person or when we are having a kind of emotional experience, we always need to consider it as both the side, like two things that seem like opposite can both be true. Before going into detail of dialectical behavior therapy is not giving it's a biopsychosocial model. It's not only focusing on a psychological basis or a biological basis. It's focusing on a biopsychosocial model of a personality disorder. So and she actually given a lot of importance to the biological basis of a person. So that is considered as a foundation of human behavior. So which affects emotional regulation, that biological basis, that may be genetic issues, family history of any psychiatric or psychological issues, temperament. These all can contribute to a kind of affect the emotional regulation. So that the social environments may reinforce their dysfunctional behavior. That is the assumption actually given by Marsha Linehan. So DBT encourages clients to be aware of the current moment and accept reality. So it's somewhat the mindfulness based kind of concept is coming up here, that the client the result is to make the client aware about the current moment and accept the reality. So here DBT tried to replace the rigid dichotomous world views. So that means the dialectic, making the client to think in a kind of dialectical framework. instead of thinking in a black and white or all or none thinking, making the client to think in a kind of, you know, that rigidity is actually reducing through that. Importance of more holistic approach to life. So more of a kind of accepting the emotions, accepting the feelings, accepting the experiences. So that is the core principle of dialectical behavior therapy. And dialectical behavior therapy also stresses the balance is important in life. It's almost all the balance in our life that is the prime focus of dialectical behavior therapy. So when we are considering the client, certain assumptions are there for this therapy. So basic assumption, client's assumptions. So according to this therapy, clients are doing the best they can in the moment. So when a person with emotionally unstable personality or borderline personality, the behavior, sometimes it's quite very difficult, like even the self-harm behavior, the anger outburst, dissociative symptoms, is all quite common in borderline personality disorders. So actually, they are doing their best to handle the situation, but it's not happening. So clients are doing the best they can in the moment. So that is one assumption. And the clients want to improve. So, I mean, when we are interacting with borderline personalities, we can understand that they actually wanted to improve, but some way or the other, it's not happening. So motivation is something very much required. That is one assumption. Clients must learn new behaviors in all relevant context. So that's another assumption. And clients cannot fail in DBT. Actually, the therapist can fail, but the clients cannot fail in DBT. Clients may not have caused all of their own problems, but they have to solve them anyway. So these are the common assumptions given in the framework of dialectical behavior therapy in the client's perspective. So next is the assumptions related with the therapist. So the most caring things a therapist can do is help the client in way that bring them closer to their own ultimate goals. So the goals set by the client. Actually, the therapist is trying to help the client to reach that ultimate goals. And the focus is clarity, precision, and compassion of the, I mean, actually considered as very important in DBT. The clarity of the work, that DBT work, and the precision of the work, and the compassion from the therapist side. So the empathy, the unconditional positive regard from the therapist side is very important. In a practical therapy sessions, you can understand that there are lots of sometimes, clients will come for few sessions and dropout used to happen. So what happened that dealing with personality disorder is something very, very difficult. So for that, we need to have that clarity, precision, and compassion is very important for continuing the session. Actually, we know that personality disorders, the sessions are not limited, like 10 sessions or 15, 20 sessions are not enough for personality disorder. Sometimes, the sessions need to be continued lifelong. So those cases, the work, the focus is very much important. The therapeutic relationship is a real relationship between equals. There is no, usually, cognitive behavior therapy and the and somehow some kind of a control is more with the therapist. But here, DBT, something like, dealing with equals. There is no hierarchy or something. So DBT therapist can fail because, sometimes DBT therapist awareness about not only the technical, the personality of the therapist also can account for the benefit of the client. Therapist treating clients need support. This is the theory, the basics of the theory, basics of the theory developed by Marshall Linehan. So how a person develop borderline personality disorders? Always when developing a therapy, we need to understand how a person, we need to formulate a person or, I mean, person psychopathology. So based on a biosocial theory of borderline personality disorder by Linehan, she explained that emotionally vulnerable person and invalidating environment. So emotionally vulnerable person, we can see that it's purely a biological predisposition. So genetic vulnerability, temperamental issues, all those things. So that lead to a kind of emotionally vulnerable person, and he's experiencing a kind of invalidating environment from the society. So that combination lead to problems in the ability to understand and label feelings because they are not able to label their feelings. Sometimes, when we are talking to borderline personality disorder people, they are I mean, other people are understanding their emotional issues. I mean, sometimes getting angry. But when we are asking to the patient is saying that, yeah, I'm getting angry. But when we are asking the patient what the exact feeling and all, it will be difficult for the client to explain. So that is one thing. They are not able to label their emotional feeling. That is happening in real sessions. So, and problems in coping skills. They know that they are having issues, they are having problems, anger issues, self-harm issues, everything, but they're not able to cope up with the problem. So whenever they are facing stresses, they don't know how to handle it. So that is a problem. Then the emotion modulation. They don't know what extent the emotion need to be expressed. So sometimes it will go beyond the level. There are instability in the emotional expression. So emotional modulation. So that is, this is the basic formulation given by Marshall Linehan. We'll go into the detailed formulation or the theoretical model of borderline personality disorder. So according to Marshall Linehan, she explained that the genetic backup of the person is something very important. So it can be family history of any psychiatric illness, mood disorder. Mood disorders are high comorbidity with borderline personality disorder. So mood disorder, family history of psychiatric issues like substance dependence, other personality issues. So then these are all genetic factors, temperament traits, and the environment, like very chaotic environment, parenting, family environment. These all lead to a kind of disorganized attachment system in the person. So that affect the person. That attachment style is not appropriate. Very disorganized way of attachment is happening. Then that temperament traits, maltreatment of the stress. There are stresses coming up to the person's life, but the person is not able to handle the stress effectively. So that lead to a kind of confused state of mind. That is integrative processing problem. That the person is not able to process the problems effectively. So what happened that the person is stressed up, and actually he or she doesn't know how to handle that stress effectively because of the backup. So what happened that dissociation is happening. Dissociation means the person losing that integrity of the personality. So what happened that lead to cognitive dysfunction. In a cognitive framework, the person started believing that I am useless, I am worthless. Sometimes person may believe that I should be loved always, I should be cared, I am vulnerable. Those kind of cognitive beliefs, that dysfunctional beliefs can develop. And the emotional regulation, that means dysregulation, that means person is not able to regulate the emotion. Sometimes, you know, getting angry, but desham varunu nu paranjal pettanu desham varuga, sangadam varunu nu paranjal pettanu sangadam varuga. Ingane bhayangaramaya fluctuations, like these kind of fluctuations are quite common. So behavioral dysregulation, suddenly getting angry, rolling over the floor. Sometimes, you know, when they are not, I mean, when they are stressed, they don't know how to behave in a inappropriately, where, I mean, how to behave, where to behave. All those things are disturbed. So these all domains, like cognitive dysfunction, emotional dysregulation, behavioral dysregulation, lead to a kind of intense, unstable relationship. Always with these all faculties, when the person is interacting with the society, that lead to intense, unstable relationship. The person is will not be able to maintain a proper relationship. Always fluctuations in relationship. When they are, you know, oraala ishtapettu kaniyal, bhayangaramayittu ishtapeduka. എന്തെങ്കിലും ബുദ്ധിമുട്ട് വന്നു കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ ഭയങ്കരമായിട്ട് അതിനോട് റിയാക്ട് ചെയ്യുക. അത്തരം ഐ മീൻ എന്താ പറയുക, ഇന്റൻസീവ് ആയിട്ടുള്ള അൺസ്റ്റേബിൾ ആയിട്ടുള്ള റിലേഷൻഷിപ്പുകൾ വന്നുപെടുക, അതിങ്ങനെ ഫ്രീക്വന്റ് ആയിട്ട് ചേഞ്ച് ചെയ്ത് വരിക. ദെൻ സംടൈംസ് ഇറ്റ് ലീഡ് ടു ഐഡന്റിറ്റി കൺഫ്യൂഷൻ. ദേ ഡോണ്ട് നോ വാട്ട് ഈസ് ഹാപ്പനിങ് ഇൻസൈഡ്. സംടൈംസ് യു നോ ബോർഡർലൈൻ പേഴ്സണാലിറ്റി ഡിസോർഡർ പേഷ്യൻസ് യൂസ് ടു കം ആൻഡ് ടെൽ ദാറ്റ് ഐ ഡോണ്ട് നോ വാട്ട് ഈസ് ഹാപ്പനിങ് ഇൻസൈഡ് മീ. ഐ ഓൾവേസ് ഫീൽ എംപ്റ്റി, ലൈക് ഐ ഡോണ്ട് നോ ഹൗ ടു എക്സ്പ്ലെയിൻ മൈ ഇമോഷൻസ്. Sometimes I feel sad. Sometimes I feel like to cry. Sometimes I feel like to scream. So, but I don't know what's the reason. I feel emptiness. So all those things are because of the identity confusion. This is the formulation given by Marshall Linehan. Based on this model, she developed certain techniques, therapeutic interventions for borderline personality disorder. So I'll sum up again the genetic vulnerability and. With that genetic vulnerability, the person is born to a kind of environment. That environment, if that environment is very negative, then negative or too much chaotic, then that can lead to disorganized attachment system, temperament traits. These all lead all how to say that, like these all in influencing the disorganized attachment system that lead to integrative processing of problem. When there are problems happening, the person is not able to handle that problem effectively, that lead to a kind of dissociating kind of situation. So that lead to cognitive dysfunction, emotional dysregulation, behavioral dysregulation, intense unstable relation, that lead to intense unstable relationship and identity confusion. So that's the thing. So we need to just understand that what are the biological vulnerabilities. So high sensitivity, feeling get hurt more easily. Small things are enough to feel them. Like sometimes, if a friend is not talking to her for one day, the person, suppose this client may feel like, that person doesn't want me. So that may be their interpretation of the situation. Often have an emotional reaction when others do not. High reactivity, like they used to be reactive. Like, the reaction is intensive reactivity will be there with this kind of diagnosis or clients. Reactions are more extreme than others. Emotions are so intense, it becomes difficult to think clearly. So when emotions coming up, the person is not able to, understand how much intensively that emotion should go or how to control that. That is losing. So it takes a long time to calm oneself down and return to normal. Sometimes, when the extensive emotion happen, it will take time to calm down. So reactions are long lasting, and this makes a person more vulnerable to the next situation. So it's a chain like reaction. So another important thing is the invalidating environment, poor fit between the person and the environment. DBT calls that poor fit, the invalidating environment. It can be parenting, like sometimes, inconsistent parenting style, some unavoidable kind of, situations in the family circumstances, some other incidents sometimes in the school, college. These all can be considered as invalidating environment. The person feeling like her emotions are not acknowledging. So sometimes, in borderline personality disorders, childhood sexual abuses are quite common. In clinical practices, we can see that. So invalidating, and the person is not able to express that emotion, intense emotion to others, hiding that emotion. The person started feeling like, if I am disclosing this to my parents, how they will react. So that means, the person feeling like, when I'm expressing my emotion, they won't be able to validate that. So for that, they're hiding that. So these all considered as invalidating environment with the person. So the environment he often rejects, like whenever I am saying something, people are not understanding, people are rejecting. They are, sometimes parents punishes and makes them feel less than, always less than, and then. So clients may begin to tell themselves the very same things. So this is invalidating environment. So actually, when you are formulating a case with emotionally unstable personality disorder, these two things need to be considered, because there will be lots of this. Actually, we need to consider in the therapy also. When sometimes, therapist side, if some kind of, negativity or not negativity, sometimes, confrontation and all happening in the session. So we need to be very careful while dealing with emotionally unstable persons. So when we are summing up the emotionally unstable personality symptoms, the affective dysregulation is one domain of borderline personality disorder. Actually, in the therapy, we are focusing how to handle affective dysregulation, problems with the anger. Actually, this affective dysregulation may with the client, that outward expression will come up like anger, extreme anger issues. She's not able to control her anger, throwing things, destructive behavior. Those things are because of the affective dysregulation. Then the other symptom, core symptom, is we need to tackle in DBT is interpersonal dysregulation. There are lots of interpersonal issues like friends, changing friends, affectionate relationship, love relationship. All those things are frequently shifting. They are not able to consistent in the relationship. So kind of very complicated kind of relation. They are going into a very complicated relationship, and the byproduct of that relationship becomes very upset, and disturbing kind of experiences for the client. And at the same time, another important thing we need to tackle in the session is fear of abandonment. actually the emotionally unstable person used to feel like, when the client is attached to a person, always kind of always a feeling like, the person may leave me. If the person is going away from me, I am nothing. So that is a kind of feeling they used to have. So that way they are doing lots of instability in their interpersonal relationship. So another core domain is self-dysregulation. So there are lots of identity disturbances. So they don't know what is their existence. I mean, in terms of self. So difficulty with sense of self, sense of emptiness. So sometimes client used to say that I feel empty, like I don't know what exactly happening in me. So sense of emptiness. The other thing is behavioral dysregulation. So serious behavior threats, impulsive behaviors. So behavioral dysregulation is sometimes, when the person is not able to control their emotions, sometimes it can lead to substance abuses, sometimes self-harm behaviors, deliberate self-harm behaviors. These all things can happen. Cognitive dysregulation means that the thinking domain, actually the clear CBT domain, that is also affecting with borderline personality disorders. So when we are moving to the dialectical behavior therapy, actually dialectical means go of black and white, all or nothing way of seeing situation. This is purely a cognitive work. Actually, in the beginning of the I just explain you that it's a continuation of cognitive behavior therapy. Actually, it's an updation of cognitive behavior therapy. Actually, that's a scenario. So here, the thinking pattern need to be worked main during the session. So actually, we are trying to change that black and white thinking or all or none way of thinking. I mean, all our way of thinking or experiencing emotions. Looking for what is left out of your understanding of the situation. Instead of going to black and white thinking, the person need to think that what is left out of your understanding of the situation. So instead of jumping into a conclusion, we need to think in that direction. So validate other person's point of view, being more flexible and approachable, avoiding blaming. So in a conclusion, we can say that you are right and the other person is also right. So that is something very important. That's purely a cognitive work, changing the person's belief into a kind of you are right and the other person is also right. Sometimes when the patient is having interpersonal issues, always say that the other person is not understanding me, he's avoiding me, he's not caring me, or he's not helping me. So in that kind of situation, the person split the emotion like black or white. So he's not helping me means he's bad. He's not caring me means he's bad. Jumping into a conclusion and saying that there is the way of that thinking. Like so, always the therapist's focus is to make change the thinking pattern. You are right, and the other person is also right. So that is purely a cognitive work. Then. The another thing is a validation. So telling someone that what they feel, believe, and experience is real, logical, and understandable. Should I feel this way? When we are having interpersonal relation, when the client is having interpersonal relationship, so during the time the person need to validate other person's point of view also. Usually in emotionally unstable personality, the view will be mainly focused on that subjective experience. Instead of that, changing that perspective, like other person perspective also, we are facilitating the client to consider. So in DBT, we learn to validate others because it helps our relationships go better. It calms intense situations so we can solve problems. Validation practices are very important in dialectical behavior therapy. There are validation practices like sometimes role reversal can be done, role play, like same like CBT procedure, we can use how to validate other person's emotions, all those stuff. Another core problem like we need to consider in dialectical behavior therapy is avoidance behavior, because most of the emotionally unstable cases, they are actually not tackling the exact emotional issue or the exact problem. So usually clients develop a habit of denial of problems, like avoiding feedback. If, for example, if somebody is coming and saying that you need to change your way of thinking, the person immediately jump into that black and white way of thinking and avoiding feedback. So non-assertiveness and social avoidance, that is something very important. They used to have in generally borderline personality disorder appear to be very assertive, but actually they are not. So that assertiveness and social, I mean that social avoidance is quite common there. So then after a point of time, that lead to a kind of heightened emotionality. So that's one thing. Drug and alcohol abuse, that is. So this is the problem in emotionally unstable person. So we can see that interpersonal conflict, for example, husband and wife. അപ്പോ ഹസ്ബൻഡ് ഈസ് ഹസ്ബൻഡിന് ഇങ്ങനെ ഫീൽ ചെയ്യാണ്, അതായത് വൈഫ് എന്നെ എൻ്റെ ഇമോഷൻസിനെ മനസ്സിലാക്കുന്നില്ല, അല്ലെങ്കിൽ എന്താ പറയാ വൈഫ് എന്നെ കെയർ ചെയ്യുന്നില്ല, അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ഇങ്ങനെയുള്ള ഇൻ്റർപേഴ്സണൽ ഒരു 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 ഇഷ്യൂ സബ്ജക്റ്റീവ്ലി ക്ലൈൻറ്റിന് ഫീൽ ചെയ്യുന്ന സമയത്ത് ആക്ച്വലി വാട്ട് ഹാപ്പൻ ദാറ്റ് ദ പേഴ്സൺ വിൽ ദാറ്റ് ഡിസ്റെഗുലേഷൻ ഇമോഷൻ ഡിസ്റെഗുലേഷൻ വിൽ ഹാപ്പൻ ദാറ്റ് യു നോ ദ പേഴ്സൺ ഈസ് നോട്ട് ഏബിൾ ടു കൺട്രോൾ ദ ഇമോഷൻ. So that actually leading to an avoidance or escape. Actually, the person is not focusing on the emotional dysregulation. Instead of focusing the emotional dysregulation, the person is avoiding that particular incident. So what happened that lead to alcohol and drug abuse, self-injurious behavior, or sometimes it can lead to aggression. So that lead to a kind of temporary relief. So even self-injurious behavior also quite connected to the biological aspect. So when the person is hurting himself or herself, the endorphin secretion will be more. So what happened that there is a pain reduction at the same time, the psychological pain also will reduce. So that is a temporary relief. So that temporary relief reinforce the emotion dysregulation. So actually what happened in borderline personality disorder is that in that what the cue can be anything, that the stressors in the, I mean sometimes failure of an examination, relationship issues, it can be a financial difficulties, whatever it is. So that cue lead to emotional dysregulation. So that actually the therapist need to work on the dysregulation part and handling cues. So that is something very important in the therapy. So this is the pattern of emo I mean pattern of development of symptoms in borderline personality disorder. So DBT procedure, like these all introduction to the DBT dialectical behavior therapy. So how to do dialectical behavior therapy? These are the steps in doing dialectical behavior therapy. The first thing is the assessment. So yeah, we know that in every therapy, like we need to understand, we need to assess the person, we need to get the detailed history of the person, like proper case history, mental status examination. That is required. At the same time, we can choose some psychometric evaluations, personality assessments, is all we can use for understanding the person. Once we understood, like complete understanding of the person, we need to come to a diagnosis. Like, what is the diagnosis? What is the problem? Diagnosis is not only just the ICD or DSM diagnosis. More than that, what are the emotionality of the person? Everything we need to understand. So once we understood the person in a kind of DBT framework, as we discussed earlier, that dialectical behavior therapy framework, we need to formulate the case. So this is the way client is suffering. This is the way my client's emotionality. So this is the way my client's personality. So that way we need to formulate the case. So once we formulate the case, we can actually have a session with the client, and we can, I mean, introduce the formulation to the client. So this is my understanding about yourself or your emotions, your feelings. So sometimes the client will say that no, this is not exactly right. The client then actually there is a freedom to the client, and the client can, the therapist can offer, like if you want to add something or if you want to change something. Actually, the client can, a client is also, also can contribute to the therapy formulation. So once the formulation is ready, check with the client again. And once the client expressed you that this is me, so there you can start your work. So then feedback about the formulation, we can say that this is my understanding. Actually, DBT kind of feedback actually we can give to the client. So then only we are moving to the therapy side. So the therapy focusing on cognitive behavioral techniques, as I told you, that beliefs are quite prominent in emotionally unstable personality disorder. So that cognitive that assumptions, beliefs, and all we need to understand. Then we need to restructure it. That is purely a kind of CBT work. So then, addition to that, core mindfulness skill, interpersonal effectiveness skill, emotion regulation skill, distress tolerance skill. These are the techniques in dialectical behavior therapy. Core mindfulness skill, interpersonal effectiveness skill, emotion regulation skill, distress tolerance skill. We'll see in detail how to work on that. The skill module, actually Marshall Linehan introduced a skill module in dialectical behavior therapy. The core mindfulness skill, the goal of core mindfulness skill is to develop a lifestyle of participating with awareness. We all know that mindfulness means, it's a kind of, awareness about the person's emotions, feelings, experiences. So actually complete awareness. So that is, in dialectical behavior, creating that into the client. So identity disturbances, sometimes, as we discussed early in the model, identity disturbances, feeling of emptiness. So those all contributing because of the identity, because of the, the awareness. So gradually through the core mindfulness skill, there are certain techniques into that that we'll discuss later. So then interpersonal effectiveness, the goal of interpersonal effectiveness skill is to apply specific skills in interpersonal encounters to obtain objectives by asking or saying no, maintain the relationship, maintain self-respect, analyze the situation, and determine goals. So handling unstable relationships, efforts to avoid loss. So that is interpersonal effectiveness. Then emotion regulation skill, the main goal is to apply specific skills to identify, label, and regulate emotions with the context of self-validation and non-judgment. So here also, like emotions, they through the therapy, we are modifying the person's skills. Actually, the person is changing their understanding of the skills to identify, label, and regulate their emotions. So that helping them to balance their affective aspects, problem with anger. Then the other thing is distress tolerance skills. So the goal is to apply specific skills to tolerate and survive crisis and to accept oneself and the current situation in a non-judgmental fashion. So impulsivity, self-harm behaviors, and all need to tackle with these distress tolerance skills. We will go into detail of all these skills, core mindfulness skill, interpersonal effectiveness skill, emotion regulation skills, and distress tolerance skills. The core mindfulness skill, actually, DBT, the core technique-wise, these are the things like core mindfulness skill. In core mindfulness skill, actually, the therapist facilitating the client to observe the feelings non-judgmentally. Like the basic principle of mindfulness, without judging, without evaluating, accepting our emotions, experiences, all. So here, actually, the therapist is facilitating the client to experience that mindfulness. So observe their feelings non-judgmentally. Like when they are judging the emotions, I mean, it will go to a kind of intense anger or intense happiness. Instead of that, just observe it without judging, without evaluating, and try to accept it. So that way, the core mindfulness skill focus. And use words to describe experience. Sometimes, what happened that we are, this is an exercise actually. So you use words to describe experiences and try to avoid emotional words. So what happened that when we are talking to an emotionally unstable person, so what happened that always the emotional experiences or the emotional words will be very much highlighted in their conversation. So that actually we are instructing, instructing the client to describe emotions instead of, and avoid emotional words, heightened emotionality, that anger, highly, emotional words need to be avoid. So allow yourself to be natural in the situation instead of that emotional part need to be taken away from the client. That is the main thing. So avoid must, should, etc. He should do this. So those statements need to be avoided, purely CBT work. So mindfulness meditation is, there are lots of meditative practices in mindfulness. So some mindfulness meditation can be practiced. these are the core main basic aspects of mindfulness meditation, or some other meditations also can be used in for mindfulness skills. So that is the first, once the person is that core mindfulness skill is something very important in dialectical behavior therapy. So the other thing is interpersonal effectiveness skill. So interpersonal effectiveness, like how to be in a good relationship with others, that understanding, perspective taking, validating other person, all those things. So getting along well in community. Always BPD patients or emotionally unstable person is to face lots of difficulty in interacting with the community, interacting with the friends, family, lots of adjustment issues. So that interpersonal effectiveness skill will facilitate them to change that negativity in the personal relationship. What is the thing that I want from this interaction? Always, what I want, more than feeling, what actually I want from this interaction, that is important. How do I want the other person to feel about me after the interaction, the result of the interaction? How do I want to feel about myself after the interaction is over? Practice reducing interpersonal skill is like sometimes, lack of skill. Like the person does not have enough skill in social interaction. Sometimes some myths will be there. Everyone must like them. Like sometimes, when we're dealing with the client, some interpersonal ineffectiveness is because of certain beliefs, certain myths. Everyone must like me. So that is one distorted thinking. So I am not a good enough person to deserve good person. I have to do everything right, or I am stupid or incompetent. So these kind of dysfunctional beliefs will be there with the person, interperson. If that is quite prominent, we need to work on that belief also. And the emotion mind. So another cause of this interpersonal is emotion mind. There is no reasonable mind actually. So everything they are viewing in the frame of heightened emotionality. And another thing is indecision, that they are not able to make proper decisions. So that all lead to interpersonal effectiveness. These all areas we need to work when we are doing DBT. Interpersonal effectiveness skill of, see, actually there are lots of exercise in DBT, skill of listening and responding, how to listen when in a kind of interaction, when we are talking emotional things, handle the wordings, the expressions, and describe patiently and politely, clearly what you want to say. So instead of filling up lots of emotions into the scenario, more than that, describe what you want to communicate. That is enough. And express, use I think instead of you should. So always feeling side the person, right? Help the person to express, use I think instead of you should, I don't want, I can't, etc. So assertiveness skill is also very much important. Assertiveness is also very much required in emotionally unstable personality conditions. So others cannot read your mind. Always that we need to focus. Reinforce, like positive effect of opposite person, like how to create a kind of positive effect with the other person when we are communicating to another person. How to create a positive effect with the other person, that we need to help them. These are all techniques, like mindful, do not distracted when expressing yourself, need to be yourself, need to be calm. These are all actually a one-to-one training, actually skill training. So sometimes, through role plays, modeling, this all we can use in this interpersonal effectiveness skill. So appear confident, negotiate, ask for alternative, gentle, no threats, no attacks. This is very important. So what happened that, because of that splitting kind of reaction, the person used to use this threat, like threatening, threat, attack, judging. This is a usual pattern, but instead of that, we are just changing that belief into no threats, no attacks, no judging. Act as interested, validate the other person's emotions. So that is, through that actually the interpersonal effectiveness skill will develop with the person. Then the third skill is emotion regulation skill. The importance of overactivation of emotional mind. So actually what happened that here you can see that there are two circles that merge together, and that part is wise mind. So that is something very much required for a person's functioning. what happened that in emotionally unstable personalities or clients, so emotion mind's activation is quite quite prominent. So reasonable mind is not working. Actually, these two part is important, but what happened that emotional regulation skill, we are actually teaching the client about emotions. What are emotions? Emotions are neither good or bad. There is no, for example, we can't consider emotions are good or bad. So there is difference between having an emotion and doing something or acting on emotion. Emotions don't last forever. That is very important. Sometimes, the intense anger, the person is feeling like this is going to continue forever. So when a strong emotion comes, you do not have to act. So that all very important. But that's the dynamism in emotionally unstable personality. Sometimes, intense emotion happen, they will react. So instead of that, we are actually facilitating the client to not to react to strong emotions. You cannot get rid of emotions. And at the same time, sometimes when we are talking to borderline personalities, they used to say that these emotions are too much, and I'm overwhelmed with these negative emotions. So always tell them that we cannot get rid of emotions. It's not possible. So emotions are part of our life. So, but the reaction, the emotional reaction need to be monitored. That's the thing. So improve emotional regulation through sleep only as much needed, that circadian rhythm balancing. Take medications as prescribed. For example, some borderline personalities, because of the intense emotionality, mood swings, sometimes some mood stabilizers will be there. So take medications as prescribed. Resist using street drugs, alcohol, etc. Once a day, do something that makes you feel mastery. Sometimes, that actually helping a lot in therapy sessions. Sometimes some creative work the client can do, nutrition, meditation, mindfulness meditation, exercise. This is actually looking like behavior activation in cognitive behavior therapy, behavioral activation. No? The same way we are doing a kind of some activities for facilitating the positive emotionality with the client. So that is through that way emotion regulation skill will develop. The other thing is the third one, distress tolerance skill. That is distress tolerance skills. So getting through the moment without making it worse by using distraction, when the person is distract, I mean try to distract when some negative emotionality is happening. Self-soothing exercise, actually self-soothing exercise, five senses are there with us. So soothing all these five senses. So that integration of five senses, this is the main philosophy behind it, like that five soothing of the five senses will calm down our emotions. So that means like it's a simple exercise. Actually, we are having five senses, see good things. Every day we need to soothe our senses. For example, if you want to soothe our eyes, see some nice visuals, sceneries, and feel it, enjoy it without judging, without evaluating, and smell something, something making you positive. So that way, like it's a self-soothing exercise, soothing our five senses effectively. That's very individual. Like for some people, music may soothe their ear. So that way, we can practice thinking the pros and cons of tolerating the distress. So what are the advantages and disadvantages of tolerating the distress? Breathing exercise, like deep breathing exercise. Counting breath techniques, these all can be used in distress tolerance. There is another exercise, these all techniques, half smile exercise, half smile in lying down position, half smile when you awake in the morning, half smile during your free moments, half smile while listening to music. These all are more of a kind of behavioral.
Actually, your question on the Twitter. Could you please suggest a simple book? Emmanuel, your talk was good. Could you please suggest a simple book?
Simple book. Okay. So actually, there is a skill book. Actually, this is the second one. The first one, Skill Training Manual for Treating Borderline Personality Disorder. That is quite good book. And there are, I don't remember exactly the author name. Usually, actually, that is for the clients. There is a module, there is a manual for borderline personality disorder. I don't remember exactly the author name. This is one in popular book, Skill Training Manual for Treating Borderline Personality Disorder. Skills Training Manual for Treating Borderline Personality Disorder. So there is another question. I often get angry because the other person is doing a job with perfection and sincerity. That is actually, see, there is no single answer for that issue, I mean that particular question. So be dialectical, that's the answer for that. Actually, be dialectical instead of, you know, jumping into the conclusion that the person is anger always because of we are, you know, we are thinking in a kind of black and white, the person is good or bad, that's what we are getting angry to the other person. Simple way, based on the dialectical principle. Okay, so thank you so much for listening to the class. So we'll discuss the case tomorrow. Thank you.